apologize for Michael Porter Jr. package deal that has Missouri thinking big. Columbia, Missouri. Once upon a time, long before the FBI started raiding college basketball offices or arresting assistant coaches, before the sleaze of the summer basketball underworld was exposed in wiretaps and indictments, few things were as radioactive as the package deal. Going back to Larry Brown hiring Ed Manning at Kansas in 1983 to get a pretty good big man named Danny, continuing in 2000 when John Calipari landed scoring prodigy Dajuan Wager at Memphis by putting his father Milt on staff and eventually spreading to numerous other arrangements at dozens of programs, it was the surest and safest, albeit most publicly contemptible way to land a star player. The transaction was there for everyone to see, even as eyes rolled and rival coaches sighed in righteous indignation. Fewer than 10 years ago, package deals were such a hot-button recruiting issue, the NCAA even made new rules to make them more difficult. Given what the sport has been dealing with the last 2 weeks, that debate seems so quaint. In retrospect, the obvious quid pro quo here, hire someone to do a job, get a player, or two, or three, along with them, might be as honest a transaction as college basketball could pull off. FBI probe, Kentucky coach John Calipari offers fixes. Adidas deal, Rick Pitino raked in 98% of the cash. Brennan, if not Louisville, then who gets the death penalty? It always has been, said legendary sneaker executive and grassroots basketball pioneer Sonny Vaccaro. It shouldn't even be questioned. It's just another rule to pretend the NCAA is protecting recruiting guidelines. Which brings us to Missouri, a program that has won 8 SEC games combined over the past 3 seasons but could very well return to the NCAA tournament and produce the number 1 pick in the NBA draft next spring in Michael Porter Jr., who is arguably at the center of the most impactful package deal in college basketball history. When athletics director Jim Stark hired Kunzo Martin from California on March 15, followed by Martin hiring Michael Porter Sr. as an assistant coach a week later, the dominoes were in place for Missouri to end up not only with Michael Porter Jr. but also his top 25-ranked younger brother Jonte, who accelerated his high school graduation to be college eligible this season. Soon after the Porters were on board, center Jeremiah Tillman, a top 50 player from East St. Louis, Ill, and top 150 guard Blake Harris followed, instantly transforming a lifeless situation into a program that was on the verge of selling out its entire allotment of season tickets late last week. None of those three guys were coming here, otherwise, Porter Jr. told USA Today Sports last week. Blake is so good, Jeremiah is so good, my brother is very good. I feel like we have every piece in the puzzle to really make a crazy story. There isn't now, and never has been, any pretense with Porter that the situation is something other than what it looks like. A longtime women's basketball staff member at Missouri, where he worked under his sister-in-law Robin Pynchon, Porter Sr., made the rare move to men's basketball in the spring of 2016 when Lorenzo Ramar hired him to be an assistant at Washington. He family moved to Seattle and Porter Jr., committed to be a Husky. When Washington fired Ramar in March, ostensibly making the Porters free agents, the idea of coming home to Columbia made sense, especially with 2 daughters, they have 8 children total, already at Missouri on the women's basketball team. Though Martin and Porter Sr. didn't know each other well, they had crossed paths in the Pac-12 and on the recruiting circuit. Coming together almost seemed preordained. Because of Robin, we knew it was a possibility that it could all come together, Stark said. I was traveling with women's basketball, and she said, you haven't seen Michael Porter play, have you? I hadn't, so I pulled up YouTube, and I was infatuated with the whole concept that it could happen if everything went right. Porter Jr. talks comfortably and openly about the idea his father's career is so directly tied to his talent, though he also said he never had any desire to play at a Kentucky or Duke, where one-and-dones are pushed through every year like cogs in a never-ending machine. Going back home to help revive a program he once watched make NCAA tournament runs was probably an even better outcome than he could have envisioned when his family moved to the Pacific Northwest. I always wanted to do my own thing and be remembered for years and years instead of being just another great player to go to an outstanding school, Porter said. I really want to leave a legacy in college. Though Porter's situation is more transparent, those kind of comments have drawn skeptical looks across college basketball whenever a top-level prospect eschews the blue bloods for a non-traditional program. Now more than ever, the idea of a coach being a so-called great recruiter carries a different connotation in the wake of an FBI investigation. Martin, who left Tennessee for a fresh start at California following his Sweet 16 run in 2014, has dealt with those hushed accusations before. In his first full year of recruiting, he landed the number 7 ranked player on Rivals list in Ivan Rabb, a local kid from Oakland who didn't want to go far from home. But the real shocker was pulling Jaylen Brown, the number 3 prospect, out of Atlanta, over Kentucky, Michigan, and North Carolina. In high school, Brown played on the Adidas summer circuit and had talked publicly about that affiliation influencing his college decision. At the end of his recruitment, though, Brown dropped the only prominent Adidas school on his list, Kansas, and chose Nike-affiliated Cal seemingly out of nowhere, even paying for an unofficial visit to Berkeley late in the process. Though Martin said he doesn't waste time worrying about the perception of college basketball recruiting these days, I don't lose sleep because I know what we're about, he said. He was sensitive enough to the chatter surrounding Rabb and Brown at the time to proactively address rumors of impropriety. Between the NCAA, compliance and the Pac-12, I was initiating calls myself, he said. They weren't calling me. I felt like it was unfortunate I had to make those calls just to stay on top of everything because I take a tremendous amount of pride in that part. We'll win and lose a lot of games for however long I'm blessed to do this, but when it's all said and done, what did you stand on as a man? I don't get consumed with nobody else and their business, but I was initiating those calls from the standpoint of, I wanted to make sure that if you hear of anything, outside the rules, see anything, let me know about it because that's not how I operate and I never will and I pray to God I'll never get involved with any of that. Though it was a career-making achievement to pull in 2 top 10 recruits at Cal, the dream season never materialized. Cal dropped out of the top 25 in November, struggled in January, then surged late in the season, climbing all the way to a number 4 seed before getting taken out in the first round of the NCAA tournament by Hawaii. That experience should be instructive for Martin, who will have to blend a group of returning veterans from an 8-23 team last year with more talented young players who may or may not be prepared to live up to the hype. Though even a short glimpse at a Missouri practice with Porter reveals a supremely smooth 6'10 scorer who has drawn comparisons to Kevin Durant, the track record of top 10 recruits trying to turn around losing teams isn't good. Whether it was Markel Fultz at Washington, Dennis Smith at NC State or Ben Simmons at LSU, they have largely had to slog through joyless freshman seasons, even if it didn't affect their draft stock. While it's impossible to assess Missouri as even a tournament team, much less a Final Four contender, Porter insists the difference for him is both the talent he helped attract and his desire to play college basketball at Missouri and not just kill 6 months waiting for the NBA. The big difference between Markel and me is that Markel didn't really have a lot of talent coming with him to Washington, Porter said. We have 3 or 4 potential pros. So even though this team wasn't outstanding last year, those guys are older, better, stronger, and I have a ton of talent coming in with me. I just feel like I won't have to take all the weight on my shoulders. To their credit, Missouri's returning players embraced the idea of a turnaround, even though it will mean Porter getting most of the shots and practically all of the attention. They joke that they can't even go out in public with him because of how often he gets stopped for pictures. Michael is who is he, junior forward Kevin Puryear said. We're extremely excited to have him here, have him represent our program. There's no ego with him. He's easy to play with. There's going to be 2 or 3 guys on him the whole game so that will leave people open and his basketball IQ is through the charts so he'll make the right play at all times. There will be opportunities for everybody. And perhaps the best thing about it, In a year where college basketball's public image is going to absorb a massive blow, is that nobody has to wonder why it's happening at Missouri. Michael Porter Sr. signed a three-year, $1.125 million contract to be an assistant coach and brought instant basketball relevance with him in the form of his two sons. Who knows whether Missouri will win a bunch of games or fall on its face before Michael Porter Jr. becomes a lottery pick. But given what we've learned recently about the sport, the idea this kind of arrangement used to be talked about as everything wrong with college basketball is laughable. Coach Porter Sr. is a good man, Martin said. They have a good family. His son is a talented player, both talented guys. It worked out. If they frown upon it, that's on them.